Yes, welcome. Yeah, so this video is to naturally follow the last four videos, all of which were on Cauchy's theorem, not to be confused with the subject of this video, Cauchy's integral formula. In this video, we'll prove Cauchy's integral formula, and in the next, we'll provide several examples showing how to apply it. Yeah? Okay, cool. So let's state it and get on with the proof. The statement goes like this. If f of z is analytic anterior to and on a simple closed contour C, then for any interior point A, it turns out that f of A is equal to 1 over 2 pi I times the integral over C of f of z over z minus A dz. And of course, the integral is a closed integral because the contour C is a closed contour, right? Okay, cool. So this is what Cauchy's integral formula says. And how do we prove that this is true? Well, this is how. No surprise, we're going to heavily rely on the idea of the crosscut. The idea of the crosscut played a vital role in all four videos on Cauchy's theorem, and I first introduced it when I showed you how to do the integral of 1 over z, so you can check out those videos to learn more about the idea of the crosscut. I'm not going to talk about it at all in this video because, well, I talked about it enough in the previous videos. Yeah, okay, cool. But yeah, what we're going to do is we're going to take the contour C, and inside it we're going to form a small circle called C sub R of radius R centered at the point A. And then we're going to apply Cauchy's theorem. First, the visual of what I just said is going to look like this. We have C, the given contour, and then centered at A is a small circle inside C, and the small circle we're calling C sub R, right? Okay. And then using the idea of the crosscut and applying Cauchy's theorem, we know that we can claim that the integral over C is the same as the integral over C sub R. And what allows us to go from this to this, which is what maintains the equality, again, is the idea of the crosscut and applying Cauchy's theorem once the crosscut is made. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, then watch the previous videos, including the video on the integral of 1 over z, and then you will know what I'm talking about, yeah? Okay, cool. But yeah, now moving forward, what it means is that instead of concerning ourselves with the integral over C, we could just worry about the integral over C sub R because, well, the integral over C is the same as the integral over C sub R. So that is that. And since C sub R is a circle, it's easy to work with. Now, notice that the integral over C sub R here can be written as this sum. And it's just quick algebra. First of all, this denominator here is the same as this denominator and this denominator, so we do not have to worry about equality of denominators. So let's check out the numerators. So f of a here multiplying dz, well, plus, if we distribute this dz to this numerator, we're going to get f of a dz plus f of z dz minus f of a dz. Oh, wait, f of a dz minus f of a dz is going to be nothing, so we're going to get f of z dz as a numerator, that's that here, and then the denominator. So yes, this left hand side of the equal sign is equal to this sum here. We just verified that. Cool. Now let's work on this integral. You should know that this integral from the videos on Cauchy's theorem is going to equal 2 pi I, but I'll kind of reinvent the wheel and do it again very quickly and show why this integral right here is going to equal 2 pi I. And it is because, well, we can switch to polar coordinates and say that this circle is defined by z equals a plus r e to the I theta, right? And then it means that z minus a, this here is r e to the I theta, but dz is going to be r e to the I theta times I. And so then substituting everything, which is substituting for dz what I just said, r e to the I theta times I, and then z minus a here is r e to the I theta, Everything in the numerator is canceled by the denominator except for the I. So you have integral from 0 to 2 pi of I d theta, and that's 2 pi I. And that's the value of this integral. And as I said, you'd know immediately the value of this integral if you watched all those videos on Cauchy's theorem, right? Okay. Cool. So now we've got that this here is 2 pi I. So far, the integral over C sub R, and therefore the integral over C, is equal to f of a times 2 pi I plus this quantity here. Now, f of z is analytic. It's differentiable, and therefore it is continuous. And so we're going to make use of that fact, the fact that f of z is continuous, in a second. And first, let's make room and remind ourselves of where we left off, which is, so far we've got this, which is that integral that was right here. I've replaced it with the value we discovered it's equal to, which is 2 pi I. And now let's worry about this here. Yeah? Okay, cool. First, as I said, we're going to make use of the fact that f of z is continuous, and it's continuous because it is analytic. Because it's continuous, it means that the limit is x goes to a of f of z is equal to f of a. But the limit that I just mentioned can be made more thorough by using a delta epsilon argument of sorts, which is to say that, well, if f of z is continuous, then the distance between f of z and f of a can be made as small as we'd like by finding a radius for that circle that will continue to shrink and shrink. In any case, like when we use the idea of the crosscut, what we did is make this circle that we showed earlier, the circle that was over here, well, we make it have a radius that goes to zero, that tends to zero. So we send r to zero anyway. But here, what we're saying is because of the continuity of f of z, we can choose epsilon to be as small as we'd like. And that subsequently would have us find smaller and smaller circles centered at a, right? So that's the kind of limit argument that is a consequence of the continuity of f of z. But what you should take away from this is that we can make epsilon as small as we'd like. Okay, cool. So how is this helpful? Well, in this quantity now, if we consider this quantity an absolute value, then first, notice that, and I have absolute value bars outside, the box is just highlighting that this quantity is what you see here, and then we put absolute values around it, and then what it means is we could put a less or equal to sign and apply the absolute value in this manner. Now, this is a triangle inequality application because, well, remember, the integral is a sum. Sigma here is a sum. So the integral is a sum, and that's why when we move the absolute value bars inside, as we've done here on the right-hand side, we're able to put this less or equal to sign. Okay, and then now we're going to apply what's called the ML inequality. I dedicated a whole video to the ML inequality and showed you how to prove it even, and so check out that video. But by applying the ML inequality, since we know that the absolute value of f of z minus f of a is less than epsilon, and we know that the absolute value of z minus a is equal to r, we can make the substitutions to apply the ML inequality and write that what we have here, this here, is by the ML inequality less than epsilon, a replacement for this, right? And then 1 over r, a replacement for 1 over z minus a, an absolute value here, right? So we have this, and then all that remains inside of our integral is the absolute value of dz. Now, again, remember, the circle centered at a has the equation z equals a plus r e to the I theta, and so then dz, as we showed earlier, is going to be this here. And so the absolute value of dz here is the absolute value of this right-hand side. Now, the absolute value of I, the norm of I, is just 1. And so the norm of r, well, it's a radius, so it's positive to begin with, but it's r. And then the norm of e to the I theta is 1. And so then what we end up with is, like, when we put absolute values around dz, that we just come out with r d theta. Okay, cool. So then this is r d theta, and of course, the integral over cr can be made as the integral from 0 to 2 pi, and that's a circle, right? And so we're doing epsilon over r times the integral from 0 to 2 pi of r d theta, and so this integral is 2 pi r, right? And think about why it's got to be 2 pi r, right? From here to here, right? And it makes sense. And if you have questions, of course, ask. But when we replace the integral with its value 2 pi r, what we're going to have is the r's are going to cancel. And so then we see that this here, and therefore this here, is bounded by 2 pi epsilon. And what we said is that we're going to send epsilon to go to 0, right? We can make epsilon as small as we'd like. So when epsilon goes to 0, this whole second integral goes to 0. What that means is that our integral over CR, this here, is equal to f of a times 2 pi I. But earlier, we said that the integral over CR, this here, was the same as the integral over C, right? We had it up here. And that's right after the cross cut, right? And so then what that means is we can replace this C sub R with C and divide both sides of this by 2 pi I, and we get the result that we claimed we can prove. And so there we are. This is what changed. So there. Yeah? Okay, cool. All right. I hope you enjoyed this. And as I said, in the next example, I will show you how to apply Cauchy's integral formula. But, you know, more than seeing examples, at least for me, it's more satisfying to watch proofs. And so I hope, this was good. Take care.